Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 37 for the 10th of April, 2022. Was that okay? Yeah, you're a good boy. This week we're going to revisit a video I shot just a few days ago about the wiring of a Singer 101 in cabinet. Mine is wired a little differently apparently than some others are. I've gotten quite a bit of feedback on that already. So we're going to take a quick peek at another 101 and compare. Also this week I've had a tremendous amount of people ask about timing adjustments on the 221 Featherweight. I had like 7 or 8 pieces of email about that. There seems to be a bit of confusion as to where you make those timing adjustments. Well, we're going to clear that up and we're going to go through the whole process. And to end it up, we're going to look at some of your machines. I get a lot of photographs sent to me of some beautiful sewing machines that you guys have restored, whatever, and we'll take a look at a couple of those too. So get your coffee, kick back, and enjoy. And hopefully he'll decide he doesn't need any more attention. Recently, I did a video about wiring on a cabinet-mounted 101, and that was specifically one individual had asked for some information on it, so I figured, what the heck, I'll put a video out. Well, turns out it looks like my cabinet mounted 101 may have been modified. It looks like mine has one of these type of connectors mounted up underneath the cabinet with the wires all connected to it. Well, it looks like the standard way the 101s were done used this style power cord, like my Bentwood case aluminum 101 uses, and here's where those power connections come in. Well, fortuitously, explaining the wiring on this is really super simple. If you recall, if you saw that video, you would recall that you have pins 1, 2, and 3. Pins 1 and 3 would be where the power actually comes in, and essentially what pin 2 is just a place for one wire from the motor and one wire from the motor controller to connect, and the other wires from the motor and the motor controller come across pins 1 and 3. And essentially pin 2 is just a bridging point. Well, on these machines, or machines that are wired using this style, it's essentially the same. This point down here, this connection point, if I take the little knobby off, just two wires coming into it. This is just a connection point, is all it is. It's just a junction. And this little block is essentially doing the same job as pin number 2 on the traditional 3-pin Singer. So it would be like pins 1, 2, 3. Otherwise, the wiring is identical, but instead of having a pin in the middle here for pin 2, that's just a junction point off on the side. That's the only difference. There's been a lot of questions about doing timing adjustments on the 221 Featherweight. So I've prepped this Featherweight here. Now, this particular machine is in as-found condition. I haven't done anything to it yet, except when I started taking it apart for this, I got an inordinate amount of lint out of it, or at least out of the areas that we're going to be looking at. What I have done, of course, I have removed the end plate here, I've removed the needle plate and the feed dog, and I've also pulled out the bobbin case and the bobbin, so we've got a clear shot at everything we're going to be dealing with. Now, you don't have to take it as far apart as I have. Honestly, when I do a timing on a Featherweight, I do take it this far apart because I like to be able to see what the heck I'm looking at. All right, Let's start first with the timing marks. You'll note at the top of the needle bar there are two lines that are scribed around the periphery of the needle bar, the upper and the lower lines. The rest of the video has already been edited. This is an insert. I want to circle back at some time in the future and do another video about this bushing and the adjustments on this bushing. The rest of this timing procedure is making the assumption that this has not been messed with. Okay? Messing with the positioning of this bushing changes a lot of things as far as the timing goes. But we're going to go forward, as far as this video goes, assuming that this bushing has not been messed with. I will circle back and I'll do a much more in-depth video about making adjustments to this bushing if somebody screwed that up. You'll note at the top of the needle bar there are two lines that are scribed around the periphery of the needle bar, the upper and the lower lines. When the needle bar linkages are at their full bottom position, which puts the needle bar at the bottom dead center position, this upper line will be even with the bottom of the needle bar bushing. If we turn the hand wheel in the direction it normally moves when sewing, that is, the top of the hand wheel moves towards the operator until the lower mark is even with the bottom of the needle bar bushing, that puts the needle bar in the proper position to check the timing of the hook. Now, if when you're checking the alignment of those marks and the upper mark is not aligned with the bottom of the needle bar bushing, when the needle bar is at the bottom of its stroke, loosen this screw here that my dental instrument is pointing at and move the needle bar up or down as necessary to make the mark line up with the bottom of the needle bar bushing. It's a good idea to secure the hand wheel so that none of the linkages move when you're making that adjustment. A simple hand on the linkages will take care of that. Now you'll note at some point in this machine's life, somebody scribed a line on the needle bar that matches up with this line here on the needle bar clamp. Here, let me lower the presser foot to show that. The reason for that is if when you loosen this this set screw and you move the needle bar up and down, you want to make sure that the needle bar is in its proper orientation so that the flat of the needle is in the right place and the eye of the needle is pointing in the right direction so that you'll get good stitch formation. That is why somebody scribed this line in here. Now, if you don't have a line scribed in, you can use the needle clamp as a guide to point. Make sure it's pointed towards the pillar. But somebody was, like I said, was nice enough to scribe the line already in this needle bar. Now, this is the tab on the hook assembly that engages in between the blocks on the bottom of the needle plate. I'm just going to push that out of the way a little bit with my dental instrument. All right, now you can see here is the point of the hook, and here is the needle. We can see that this machine is perfectly in time because the point of the hook is directly in front of the needle here. There is no mistaking about it. This machine is perfectly timed up. But what if it wasn't? What would we do? Where would we make those adjustments? So in order to answer that question, I'm going to put the machine on her side. So let me get the camera shot changed and get this all set up. Wow, this machine is a lot dirtier than I had thought. Like I said before, this is in as found condition. There's a couple of set screws on the bottom here that you might be tempted to make the adjustments at, but only one set of them is the correct place to make the timing adjustments. So I'm going to explain what's going on. You have set screws, two of them, down in here on the left that connect the hook to this bottom shaft. There's a set screw here that holds the bushing in place, and I'm going to take it out of time for the moment. There's a set screw here on this counterweight. In addition to all that, there's set screws back here on this gear. Now, where to make the adjustment if timing is out? It's back here at this gear. I'll explain why. When you adjust it up here at the hook, there's a distinct possibility you're going to move the hook either too close or too far away from the needle. That's what this adjustment's for up here, is to adjust the position of the hook to the needle. Likewise, don't go messing with the set screws at the counterbalance or at the bushing. Leave those alone, unless, of course, there's an adjustment required for the hook-to-needle clearance. You make the timing adjustments back here, and it could not be easier. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put this machine back into the timing position. Okay, it's back there. What one would do, loosen one set screw first. Okay? Then get her back into so that the timing marks line up like they're doing right now. Now I've got a screw that's accessible. I would loosen that screw, and while sticking my head around to the other side of the machine, I could grasp the counterbalance here with two fingers, or thumb and index finger, and move the shaft to get the hook exactly where I want it. A good idea to do is to grasp the balance wheel like this so it doesn't move. Just kind of pressure it together so it doesn't move. Then you can move this, get it all lined up so that the needle and the point of the hook are in proper alignment, then tighten up the screw that's exposed. Get it good and tight. Double check to make sure it's in alignment. Once you're satisfied with that and that first set screw is tight, rotate it back, tighten the second set screw, put the timing mark back where it belongs, double check your timing. Don't put the timing where it belongs, put the timing marks where it belongs to make sure you didn't affect the setting. Well, kids, that's all there is to timing a 221. It's actually pretty simple. If you've got a modicum of mechanical skills and halfway decent eyesight, you can do this. Just remember, check your timing marks first, then get as much stuff out of the way as you need to. Now, I took all this stuff off here to make it easier for you to see, but honestly, when I do timing on one of these, even if it's just me and I'm not worried about the camera, I take the feed dog off. I want to be able to see. So, lined up, all the garbage off here, check the position of the point of the hook to the needle. If it's right, great. Then check the needle bar height. The needle bar height should be so that the point of the hook, approximately 1/16 of an inch to the top of the eye of the needle. That simple. If you have to change the timing, if you have to adjust it, do not use the set screws up in this area. Use the two set screws on the gear on the horizontal shaft towards the pillar side of the machine. It's always a good idea, if you're going to be doing that, to, once you have those set screws loosened, grip the hand wheel in some way so that it's not going to move. When everything's lined up with all your marks, get it all gripped, and then use the counterbalance on the shaft, and use a couple of fingers to move it till everything's lined up perfectly. Tighten one of the set screws good and tight. Rotate as necessary to get to the other set screw. Crank that down, put the timing marks back where it belongs, double check your timing. It's that simple. Now it's time for one of my favorite segments, looking at pictures that you guys send in of your project machines. We're going to start this week with yet another one from Bill Maguire. Bill sent this pictures of this absolutely gorgeous Lotus 66 in a parlor cabinet. The machine is quite beautiful, but the cabinet is absolutely stunning. I know I wish I had one, but then again, I don't have the space for a parlor cabinet either, so I guess it's better off over at Bill's place. Anyway, great find, Bill. Congratulations. Move along to John Schaefer. John sent these pictures of this really beautifully repainted and redecaled 192 Spartan.
I don't know if John Schaefer was inspired by my International Harvester Red 66 or not, but he certainly did a bang-up job with this absolutely gorgeous 192K Spartan. Fantastic work, John. It looks great. Teresa Golding sent in these pictures of a 66 repainted in a stunning blue with Lotus decals. Teresa, if you ever want to get rid of that machine and you don't call me, I will never forgive you. I would love to have one like that in my collection. And last but not least, my good friend Megan Mills down in New Zealand sent me a picture of her current project machine. Nice little old Model 20. Now, in addition, Megan also sent me a whole bunch of other documentation, including some beautifully scanned material, one of which is the owner/operator manual from 1922 with updates at 1926. And she's given me permission to put that up on my website to distribute that to everybody. So I'm going to be doing that. And Megan, keep us posted on how you come along with your Model 20. Those things are real cute. I've got one. I haven't had a chance to mess with it yet.
Planning for our live session is still going strong. Poll results are starting to come in, although I'd kind of like to see a little bit more responses before making a decision of what we're going to be doing, first of all. And so I'm going to leave the poll up for like another week. Anyway, that's all Roscoe and I have for you. So thank you all so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one. You okay with that? Yeah, you don't care as long as somebody's holding you. He's a good boy.